Namaskar. Very good afternoon, dear learners. I, Dr. Renu Tomo, welcome you again as to discuss relevance of Indian thinkers on education. Dear friends, this is part 3 of the series of lectures on relevance of Indian thinkers on education. If you remember, in first two lectures, we have discussed that why is it so relevant in the present context to discuss importance of Indian thinkers, and how the role of Indian thinkers became so important during the Renaissance of Indian education, that is 19th century. Friends, if you remember, in our previous lectures, we also talked about Indianization, as well as we talked about that in 19th century, why, due to the impact of Western education system, the Indianization began and the education was seen in a different perspective, different from what it was being seen previously. And education was also regarded as a tool by most of the thinkers who were social thinkers as well as philosophical thinkers, and had an important role to play in the education, because they saw education as a tool to change the system, as to change the socio-political system. Friends, if you remember, the objectives which we had taken up in the initiative stage of this lecture was relevance of education, thoughts of Indian thinker to the present education system. In that objective, we discussed about Indianization of education system as well as Indianization of social system. Then we also talked about aim and functions of education as well as the pedagogy with respect to the philosophy or the social dynamics of the 19th century or 20th century as well. Then we also talked about the pedagogical practices in the classroom as being influenced by the thinkers, and we also talked about that how teacher and student relationship has an impact in the class, and how it is also having an impact from the socio-political system as well as the philosophy to which the teacher belong or the pedagogy belong, that is the subject which is being taught by the teacher. We have also discussed value and qualities which are needed in a teacher to prepare a child for the life, and that was also discussed in the context of India, that is what is expected in Indian socio-political system or socio-economic system. We have also discussed few philosophers. So, taking on from the philosophers which we have discussed, like we discussed Dayanand Saraswati, we discussed Raja Ram Mohan Roy, today we shall be going further and we shall be discussing M.K. Gandhi. If you remember that when we discussed Dayanand Saraswati, we talked about the importance of discipline in the education system as it was seen by the Dayanand Saraswati. We also talked about that how the history has an impacted. When we were discussing all those things, friends, the context in which all these points or objectives were discussed by us, if you remember, were regarding the three areas in which philosophy of education can be divided. If you remember, we had discussed that philosophy of education can be divided into three classes only, and the first class is just to study, the simply study education of philosophy, educational thoughts, ideas or contribution of individual thinkers, or in comparison to the other. And if you remember, this first aspect of philosophy of education has most of the thinkers or most of the researchers also. That means the 50% of the educationist or researcher are trying to study these aspects only, that is critically studying the educational philosophy, critically studying the educational thoughts. Here we cover isms. Here we cover also contribution of individual thinkers, may it be John Dewey or may it be Rabindranath Tagore or Mahatma Gandhi. And then we also compare with each other. For example, comparing Dewey with Rabindranath or Dewey with Mahatma Gandhi. So, these are the research areas which are covered in this particular aspect, and other two aspects which we generally cover in philosophy of education are exploration of epics, historical period and religion. Friends, if you remember, in this particular aspects, what we are concerned about is what we discussed in our previous lectures was that this aspect deals with the Vedic period, these aspects deal with the invasion by the Mohammedans and the change of education accordingly. So, these are also discussed, and the rest of the half of the researcher or educationist fall into the second category and the third category. Third category is about finding out the social relevance of the philosophical system, that is trying to find out that how these systems are to be explored, that is thematic and conceptual studies which are related to education or philosophy of education. So friends, now going ahead, moving ahead on this journey of relevance of Indian thinkers in philosophy of education, now let us try to discuss the other thinker and to take up the first thinker who is very important, is Mahatma Gandhi. Friends, in our previous lecture we have discussed Raja Ram Mohan Roy as well as Dayanand Saraswati, and while discussing with them we also discussed that how they came out with the solution to the problems, the social issues, in and that solution was cited by all of them in the form of education, and how they were concerned about the women education as well as the social evils which existed during that period. So that was also taken up by them. So friends, now let us talk about, before we talking about Mahatma Gandhi, I would like to discuss Vivekanand. Vivekanand, as all of us know, is an important name, is an important name, not just in the sociology, but also in the philosophy as well as education. His contribution to the education thought is treated as of supreme importance by most of the educationists. Why? Because he gave definition of education in very simple terms. He said education is nothing but an instrument of social change. So he studied education as a philosopher as well as a scientist, and he said that education should cover all aspects of life, that is the material aspects. Material aspects mean the physical, moral or intellectual, and it should also be covering spiritual and emotional aspects. So that makes education a very constant and dynamic process, because it will always be influenced by the society, it will always be influenced by economic as well as the political scenarios. So this is one of an aspect which Vivekanand has cited about. And in fact, when we talk about modernization, and modernization was first, we would say, worded or seen or perceived in its absolute role as an absolute expected outcome by Vivekanand. And his attitude towards modernization was that masses should be educated, and before doing anything in the society to be modernized, society should have everybody educated. And he wanted to remove four major evils from the society. One was priestcraft, second is poverty, third is ignorance, and fourth is tyranny of the wise. Friends, those of us who have studied Vivekanand, we know that Vivekanand has given very importance. He has given importance to the fact that there are only small group of people who are influencing the socio-economic system in India. And the result is they are the tyrants of social system. They think themselves to be the very wise people, and they are also seen as wise people in our society at large. He said to make people of India understand what is a modernized world, as well as to contribute in the socio-political system. It's very much important that political and social strength becomes the foundation to the cultural strength. And as a cultural strength, masses should be educated. So the foundation of cultural strength is education. In fact, the vision of philosophy of education in the cultural context, as he saw, was the aims of education according to Vivekanand were, first, creation of self. What does self means? Self doesn't only mean the physically fit person. Self means the person who is having infinite power, and he or she is a will aware of those infinite power. He or she confident about himself and strives to reach the highest goal of his or her life. The self-confidence is to such an extent that the person realizes one's own self. If we look at it from the Maslow's perspective, then Maslow has also given the most maximum importance to the self-realization, self-actualization as he called it. So, if we equate it with that, then we understand that to be developed, any nation, any society needs masses who are self-realized, because he talked about education of masses, and that he said is the first requirement for any community or society to be modernized. So, from there on he said that education to become available to all the masses, as well as to have the impact in the life of people, shall have certain aims, and the first aim of education should be to instill people with the confidence, instill people with the self-realization, instill people with the realization of their own self. So, in Swamiji's own word, faith in us and faith in God, this is the secret of greatness, and this is the aim of education, to make people realize this particular realization, that is faith in us and faith in God, is the secret of greatness, and everybody, each one should be striving to be become great. The second aim, as it was given by Swami Vivekananda, was formation of character, because he believed that character is the most important component of the community or the society. Now, let us try to understand what is character as far as Vivekananda is concerned. What does he mean by character? As per him, the character is that we know what our thoughts are, we are aware of our thoughts, and education should be aiming at sublimating the evil tendencies of our mind. He accepted the fact that each individual has an evil side to oneself, and the purpose of education is character building, and in character building it should be doing what? It should be sublimating the evil tendencies of mind of people. And the what is the character? Character is the aggregate of man's tendency, that is sum total of bent of his mind. And we know that bent of mind can be positive as well as negative, because what are we? We are just thoughts. What are others? Others are also just thoughts, because people stay in thoughts as well as people work in thoughts, and we are the people who work at the mental level. Third aspect which Swamiji talked about was development of personality. What is personality? Personality is the influence, the impression which one creates on another. It is the personality of man that counts. According to Vivekananda, personality is 2/3, and his intellect and words are only 1/3 in making the real man. Now, he has differentiated the two aspects of the human being. One is personality and the second is intellect. How personality is different from the intellect? Now, let us try to understand. Personality means how far we are able to reach the people, how far we are able to influence the people. And being intellect is not sufficient in oneself. In fact, as Vivekananda said, that 1/3 of the intellect is there in the real man. That means if we try to understand the personality of the person, then we would say that the personality, that is the characteristics to influence the other, has 2/3 of his total persona, and 1/3 is that of the intellect and words which he speaks or write or he says. So, development of personality is also an important aspect which Vivekananda has talked about. And the fourth aspect which he has talked about as aim of education is service of mind. What does service of mind means? Service of mind is that we, as Vivekananda, what is God? God is the person. God exists in the individuals, as he accepted and said that the God exists in the poor people of India. It is God in the sick, it's God in the poor, it's God in the miserable, it's God in the ignorant, who has to be worshipped, who has to be attended to. So, in Swami Vivekananda's own word, if you want to find God, then serve man. And this should be aim of education also. Education should be aiming at creating individuals who are ready as well as who wants to serve people, serve individuals as gods. That is service of mind. The fifth aim, which he has referred to in his various texts, which he has reproduced as well as in various speeches he has given in the world at large, was promotion of universal brotherhood. As Vivekananda said, that the love for mankind knows no geographical boundaries. So, education should be aiming at promoting universal brotherhood, and this is one of a very important aspect of education. Another the fifth aim is promotion of universal. What is universal? As I said, that through education we should gradually read the idea of universal brotherhood by flinging down the walls of separation and inequality. In every man, in every animal, however weak or miserable, great or small, resides the same omnipresent and omniscient soul. Difference is not in the soul, but in the manifestation. So, what should be the aim of education? Aim of education should be to make people realize that the soul is same in everybody, but because there is a difference in the manifestation, so it is important, it is for every individual to do, that is to serve, so that it can be manifested in the best possible manner. The sixth aim which Swami Vivekananda gave of the education was the aim of keeping in view the practical aspects of life. As we know that Vivekananda didn't say that the education, philosophy or religion should ever be aiming at taking people away from the practical aspects of life. He said that spirituality exists in the common man's life, and being spiritual doesn't mean that you should leave your duties and leave your responsibilities toward the society at large. He believed that it will be possible to make an individual self-dependent and country prosperous if we attend to the practical aspects of life. He believed that it is not merely to listen to the great principle, but also it is very important that we apply those principles in the practical field. The principles should not exist as the thoughts, as a philosophy. Rather, they should come down as the practical aspects, and they should become the constant practice. Only then they are important. The seventh aim of education, as far as Vivekananda is concerned, is aim of physical and mental development. This aim of education means that child should be able to promote national growth and advancement, and he should also be catering to becoming fearless as well as physically well developed citizen of tomorrow. So, education should stress the mental development of the child, and Swamiji wished education to enable the children to stand on their own feet and become economically independent rather than becoming the parasites on others. So, education should aim at making people potentially strong, mentally strong, as well as potentially strong enough to serve the nation, to serve the community, to serve the society, and by that they would be able to get the best out of their life as well as best out of their personality. So, this is what Swami Vivekananda believed when he talked about that the aim of education is moral and spiritual development. According to Swami Vivekananda, the nation's greatness is not only measured by its parliamentary institutions or activity, but also greatness of its citizen. What does that mean? That the citizen should be morally and spiritually developed. Only then we can say that the nation is educated, nation is developed, and nation is great. So, this is something which he believed, that nation cannot be great because nation has supremacy over certain other nations, so supremacy economically. To become great, it is very important that we are able to educate our citizens to become morally and spiritually developed as well as upright. The eighth aim, as given by Swami Vivekananda, is of searching unity in diversity, because as we have discussed already, that Vivekananda believed that despite the geographical diversity, despite the political diversity, there is a unity in all elements of the universe. Now he is not only talking about the globe, the earth or the countries, he is talking about the universe. So in the universe there is certain unifying elements, and education should make students capable of searching out as well as realizing that unity in diversity. He asserted that physical and spiritual worlds are one. Their distinction is an illusion, that is Maya. And education should develop this sense which finds unity in diversity. So, the aim of education is also to make people look beyond Maya, that is illusion. And what is illusion? Illusion is the physical, physical and spiritual worlds. And another aim of education as cited by Vivekananda is aim of religious development. Now, as we have already discussed, that religion for Vivekananda is not what we usually see, because he never accepted the fact that religion means worshipping blindly. Rather, for him, the individual should search out and develop certain religious seeds which are embedded in him. And that has to be done to find the absolute truth or reality. So, he advocated the training of feelings and emotions so that whole life is purified and sublimated. So, for him, the religion is not following certain features or just reading the scriptures or following them blindly. Rather, it was thinking and finding your own religion and training one's own feelings and emotion in such a manner that we have purified and sublimated life. Friends, on this note, we will finish off with the contribution of Swami Vivekananda in education. In fact, if we talk about contribution of Swami Vivekananda, they are very large, and if we discuss them further, then it will take not just hours, but it will take months and years, because Swami Vivekananda in himself was, we can say that he is himself a subject, he is himself a discipline. Now, let us try to discuss another person, another political person as well as educationist who has maximum impact on the education, that is Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, our own father of the nation. M.K. Gandhi's contribution to the education is unique in a way, as we all of know that he has a different kind of a political principles, and he believed in socio-political elements being highlighted, and for that he saw education differently. In fact, he was the first one, the first Indian who advocated scheme of education based upon essential value of Indian culture and civilization. So, Mahatma Gandhi not just believed that to have the perfect education, we shall be focused on essential values of Indian culture and civilization. Rather, he was the worst critic of colonial system of education, because he perceived that colonial system of education is harmful to India. According to Gandhiji, colonial system of education was, one, it was based upon foreign culture, and that foreign culture almost destroyed the local culture, because it made the people perceive foreign culture as a better off culture, and that way they destroyed their own strength, their own culture. So, this was something which was criticized by Mohandas Karamchand Gandhiji. Then the second aspect which he saw as a criticism of the system which was advocated by the English people, the colonial system of education, that the education system has limited itself to educating mind, and in fact it has completely ignored the education of heart and hand. Thirdly, he criticized the education system because of the fact that right education is not possible through foreign language. He was the first person who advocated that education has to be taught through mother tongue. And because mother tongue reaches not head but heart, that is why it is very important that we teach children through the mother tongue. His philosophy of education is harmonious blending of idealism, naturalism and pragmatism. We shall be discussing further details about the philosophy of Gandhiji as well as his impact and influence on the education system during that time. For that, we shall be joining you soon. On this note, I, Dr. Renu Tomar, is signing off with a promise to join you back again as to discuss the influence of Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi ji on education system. Namaskar, good afternoon, have a good day. Jai Hind.